Okay, so to be respectful of everyone's time, we're going to go ahead and get started. But what I'm going to do first is I'm going to do the roll. So if you were here last week, we got your roll through the test. But this week, we'll just do your roll by calling out your name. I'm going to do the roll actually twice. Mm-hmm. I'll do the roll at the beginning, and then I'll just follow up again near the middle to see who's here, because I know that some people may come late. So when I call your name, if you can just take your yourself off of mute and then just say here or present. Pat McLeod. Sandra Aldolphus.
Yes, I'm here.
Okay. Victoria Medlock. Okay. Vivian Campbell. Lori Sims. Linda Holloway. Janice Williams. Sandra Jones.
Present.
Okay. Joyce Moore. Eugenia Shepherd. Would somebody respond? I can't see a picture. Regina? Eugene, I meant to say. I apologize about that. Okay. Dion Thomas. Janet Webb.
Present.
Janice Macon.
Present.
Okay. Kalita Gardner.
Present.
Okay, wonderful. Michelle Law. Jacqueline Thompson.
Present.
Okay. And Vanessa Francis.
Present as well.
Okay, wonderful. Is there anyone that's present that I did not call?
Beverly Atkins Hall.
Okay, Beverly Atkins Hall. Anyone else? Okay, so what we'll do is we'll go ahead and get started. And so I'm going to do the slide. I'm going to do the presentation today using slides. On the next session, I'm going to show you the manual and talk about that some. Everyone should have gotten an email, and that in that email is a link to the manual that NHLBI has. So you have the link to the manual that NHLBI has, as well as the picture cards. When we meet in person on November 12th, we're also going to give you the physical copy of the manual in a notebook so that you'll have that. I'm going to also, after we finish the training, give you access to the slides so that if you do it virtually. Now,
there's no cost for the manual?
No, there's no cost to the manual. The NHLBI, National Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute, provides the manual for free, as well as other resources. But we're going to give you the hard copy of the manual when we see you in person. We'll have the virtual copies of the manual and the picture cards. I'm going to go over those at the beginning of the next session and then show you how it's used. Because when you see the manual, when you see what I do, it provides you all the information you need. So what you can see, actually, if you were to open your manual, is that everything that's in my slides are in the manual, word for word, just about. I mean, I cut and paste and left some things out, but what I'm saying is in the manual. And that's important because when you teach it in the community, it's very important that you stick to what's in the manual. Individuals may ask you questions about different things that you're talking about, but you want to rely on the manual because that's evidence-based, right? And it's information that has been vetted by the doctors. You may share your personal experiences, that's okay, but you don't want to get into like giving medical advice or, you know, telling someone something you heard that you don't know if it's factually based or not, because what that can do is really hurt credibility in terms of talking to the community about this. Unfortunately, we're in a time right now where even medical science, you know, is being doubted or questioned. So we want to make sure that when we're talking to the community, we're engaging them in a way that they will trust what we're saying. But I'm going to do that. I'm going to go over the sessions in the manual, like by showing you the manual in the next session. But I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. I will say that once I start sharing my screen, I'm not able to see you all. So if you have any questions, I will stop. You can just, you know, make a note, say, hey, you have a question, and ask your question. But once I start sharing my screen, it's just difficult for me to see. Before I do that, though, before I get into the lesson for today, I'm just going to share the schedule. So last week, we had the opening session, the introductions. We had a pretest. We talked about the expectations, and then we had Advocacy 101. That was last week. This week, we're doing two sessions from the manual, Knowledge is Power, and Reacting Time to Heart Attack Signs. So that's session one and session two of your manual. Next week, which will be November 1st, we're going to go over Embrace Your Health, Aim for a Healthy Weight, and also Get Energized, Say Yes to Physical Activity. So we'll do those two sessions manual next week. You might notice that I skipped 4 and 5. I skipped 4 and 5 because those are sessions that I want to do in person. I'm going to go over the in-person schedule in just a second. But next week will be our last virtual session like this. Now, there is self-directed learning. I tried to do it so that all of the self-directed learning are not in the manual. When the ABC does this program, we also have ABC cardiologists teach some of the sessions. What we're going to do is we're going to get in touch with those the cardiologists, record them teaching the sessions, and then we're going to make it so that you can go on your own time whenever you feel up to it, watch those sessions, and then take a test. But we haven't done the recordings yet for those sessions. Those are something that we'll do in the next couple of weeks. On November 12th, we're going to meet in person, and then we're going to complete the With Every Heartbeat is Life Community Health Worker training by doing session 4, 5, 7, 8, 9, and 10. There may be one or two of those sessions that we skip. Some of those sessions are going to be where you teach us. So I'm going to probably assign those to you before we meet in person. But we'll have our in-person meeting on November 12th to wrap up.
How long is that going
to
be?
It's going to be an all-day session on November 12th. From
what
9
time
to
start? Go ahead.
Pardon?
Go ahead.
I was just going to say from about 9 to 5.
Oh, my God.
Yes. Because we want to go ahead and complete going through the manual. We'll try to make it entertaining for you as possible. It's going to be at Pastor Curry's church. We'll have some food for you for lunch, and then we'll be able to give you the manual. We're going to give you other items to really do this out in the community. Okay. So I'm sorry. Go ahead. Miss Vicky, you were going to ask something?
Oh, no. No, no. I was okay. Just, let me make sure I'm muted.
Okay. Yes, and if you don't mind, just if you can mute your phones when I start. I can't see you to be able to mute you, so I will need you to mute yourself. Yes.
Now, I just wanted to let you know that Johnice is having some internet problems, but she has dialed in, and she's at the 1407.801 phone number.
Okay, let me go ahead and just check that she's here.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. I am.
Okay, wonderful. And we are recording these sessions as well. So we'll make it available to you. I haven't gotten in touch with my IT person. You know, as I said, I was traveling this week. I actually just got back in today from Savannah, Georgia. But I'll work with my IT person to make these available. so that if you miss a session, you can join. But we don't want you to miss too many sessions. The way we usually do it is that you have to attend 70% of the sessions in person. What's going to make that easier for you is that we're doing quite a few sessions on that November 12th. And so you have sessions that you can watch if you miss. So I'm going to go ahead and get started. And as I said, if you have a question, feel free to just raise your hands, because once I start sharing the screen, it's hard for me to see what's going on. So the session that we're talking about today is called Knowledge is Power. Know your health, know your risk for heart disease. So, you know, you'll hear often as we go through these sessions that it's important to know your numbers, know your status in terms of diabetes, know your status in terms of cholesterol. And so in this chapter, what we're going to talk about is really the knowing part of knowing your risk for heart disease. There are many factors that are in your risk for heart disease, and we're going to cover those today. But all of the sessions start with a quote. And the Reverend Jesse Jackson once said, "If my mind can conceive it and my heart can believe it, I know I can achieve it." Now, when you teach this session out in the community, so I'm going to go through the sessions pretty quickly. Because I go through them pretty quickly, there are several things that I kind of skip. Like there are several sessions, for example, where you might have the audience participate and read the skits, right? So there are skits in the program that you can get the audience involved. There's other parts that really help you to engage the audience and get the audience involved. Because one, we're doing it virtual, you know, it's hard to get you involved virtually, but also because, you know, it would take a lot longer if I went through the skits and did the activities. For that reason, I'm not going to do the skits and activities. But when you do it out in the community, it's very important that you do the skits and activities, because that helps to engage the audience and get them involved and they participate. This is going to seem more like a lecture. I'm talking to you. I'll try to make it as entertaining as possible. Being that it's virtual, that's a little difficult as well. But when you teach the manual, you want to capture your audience's attention, make them excited about learning this information, and then get the knowledge to them by helping to interact with them. So what I would usually do if we were in person is I would say, well, what does this quote mean to you? Reverend Jesse Jackson said, "If my mind can conceive it and my heart can believe it, I know I can achieve it." And what that is that we have to envision the life we want to have, the health we want to have. So myself, you know, I just turned 51 a month ago. And, you know, I want to envision myself getting to 65, getting to 70, retiring, enjoying retired life. But in order to do that, I have to make sure I live a healthy life, you know, controlling for heart disease, controlling for diabetes, and controlling for cholesterol. And so one of what this quote means is that, you know, sometimes it takes envisioning what we want to happen. We need to conceive it with our minds and believe it in our hearts that we can get there. And when we do that, we can really make things happen. But sometimes we may have a hard time seeing, you know, hey, what's down the road. It's important for us to help our community members appreciate that having good health is very important to envisioning that long life. So as we talk about the manual and go through the manual uses the Harris family and friends of the Harris family to explain cardiovascular disease and its impact on the family. So you're going to go through and you're going to meet Mother Harris, that's here in the middle with the gray hair. You know, she's the matriarch of the family. She's the one that really helps the grandmother, you know, that really brings the family together. And then you're going to meet the rest of the family, the uncles, the brothers, the cousins, and how Mama Harris, how her health impacts everyone else's health through family history, through her giving knowledge, through what she does in the kitchen when she cooks. She can influence the rest of the family as well. So As we go through these lessons, you want to kind of picture, hey, you know, what is your role in helping the family live a healthier life? Are you the one that does most of the cooking? And if so, maybe you can help by taking those steps by starting to reduce salt in the that's in the food, cooking with less fat, removing the skin, for example. But as we go through, we're going to talk about the Harris family, and then we're going to see strategies that they use that we can use in our own lives as well. But this program is about the heart. You know, it's about how do we start helping our communities understand the impact of heart disease, and then changing our lifestyles so that we can live a healthier life. Now, I believe it may say it in one of the, so heart disease is disease of the heart itself. So whenever you hear the term heart disease, we're talking about diseases of the heart. Another term you may hear is cardiovascular disease. So the cardio part of that is heart, vascular part of that is the vessels. And we're going to talk about the vessels a little later. But cardiovascular disease encompasses, now we're talking about not just the heart, but also the vessels, the arteries and the veins as well, and diseases that impact those. So if you hear heart disease, That's specific to disease of the heart. When you hear cardiovascular disease, that involves the heart plus the vascular system that impacts health. So the heart, though, is an amazing part of the body. In a single day, and usually when you teach this out in the community, you want to have props. And I don't have the one prop with me. I'd have it down here somewhere, but I can't get to it right now. But in a single day, the heart can pump 100,000 times in a day and pumps about 2,000 gallons of blood through the body. So usually what I would do is I would have a quart of liquid. And we know that there are 4 quarts in a gallon. And so I would hold up that quart and it looks like a lot of water. And you say, okay, it's pumping this, like, and it's pumping it so often that it seems just unconceivable that this small little organ in our body can do all that work. But in order to do all of that work, it has to keep pumping, right? It has to pump that 100,000 times a day. It has to pump that 2,000 gallons of blood throughout the whole body. You know, this manual is called "With Every Heartbeat is Life." If the heart ever stopped beating, then that's the end of life. And so that's what we're trying to prevent here. Now, the heart receives the blood that has oxygen and nutrients in it. And the blood carries that oxygen and nutrients to all of the organs in your body so that they can work properly. If something happens and that blood is not able to get to certain areas in your body, it's not able to get to your feet, it's not able to get to your brain, it's not able to get to other parts of your body, then that can impact those organs' ability to function, and eventually they'll start dying. And so if that happened in the legs, for example, you can have gangrene occurring in your foot. If it starts happening in your brain, then that's a stroke. So the heart is very important for pumping that blood around, and that blood is very important for carrying oxygen and nutrients to all of the organs in your body. So we know that your heart is vital to your health and nearly everything that goes on in your body. So it's important to protect your heart. Now, healthcare providers can determine or learn a lot about your health simply by, you know, checking how fast your heart is beating and how it's doing. And you can check your pulse. And so what that is just to take 2 fingers and then you place them, you know, usually your index finger and your middle finger, place them on your wrist near your thumb. So you have your thumb here. If you come down your thumb and then right into your wrist, there's an area here that you can feel a little pulse. And that tells you how fast that your heart is beating, your pulse does. Now the heart, I'm going to talk about now what the heart looks like. And over the next few slides, you'll see that the heart is made up of 2 sides. There's a right side of the heart and there's a left side of the heart. It's also made up of a top layer and a bottom layer. So in total, you have four chambers. You have a top left, a top right, you have a lower left and a lower right. Now, that top right, so the top of the heart is called the atrium. And you know, it's four chambers. The two top chambers are called the atrium. So the right side, you have your right atrium. Your left side, you have your left atrium. The bottom chambers are called your ventricles. You have your right ventricle and your left ventricle. So the septum divides the heart into two sides. Each side of the heart, as I just mentioned, has an upper chamber called atrium and a lower chamber called ventrium. Blood that has to move through your body and is low in oxygen enters the right atrium. So what's going to happen is you have these huge vessels called your vena cava. You have your inferior vena cava and your superior vena cava. And that's your largest vein system, is your vena cava. Your inferior and superior vena cava are going to dump into your right atrium. So that's blood that's coming back from the body. It's low in oxygen. So blood entering the right atrium from the vena cava is low in oxygen. That blood is going to then go down into your right ventricle. And then your right ventricle is going to pump that blood low in oxygen to the lungs, to the through the pulmonary arteries. The blood's going to go to the lungs where it will pick up more oxygen, right? So think about your vena cava, superior vena cava, inferior vena cava, dumping into your right atrium. That dumps into your right ventricle. That goes into your pulmonary arteries, which goes to the lungs. In the lungs, the blood's going to get oxygen, and then it's going to come back to the heart through your pulmonary arteries, your pulmonary vein. Your pulmonary vein is going to jump into the left atrium. So in each case, the right atrium and the left atrium is receiving blood into the heart. They're taking blood into the heart. When it's going into the right atrium, that's coming from the body. When it's going into the left atrium, that's coming from the lungs. It's going to then go down from the left atrium into the left ventricle. And then your left ventricle, which is the biggest part of your heart, you know, the hardest, the one that's the hardest working, is going to squeeze down and push all that blood into your aorta and then out to the body. So if we were to track the blood flow, you would I'm going to go back for a minute. If you were to track the blood flow, it goes into your, from your inferior and superior vena cava, right atrium, right ventricle, pulmonary artery. Then it comes back to your right, your left atrium, your left ventricle, and then out to the body. Now, as I mentioned, your heart is the center part of all of this activity in your cardiovascular system or your circulatory system. The other components of your circulatory system include arteries and capillaries and veins. So arteries will take blood away from your heart, right? They send blood out to the body or to the lungs. Arteries always go away from the heart. The capillaries are those small networks that allow the organs to get oxygen because they get really small and really tight. And then because they are that way, oxygen can move out of the red blood cell and into the organ where it's needed. After the oxygen has been, you know, left the red blood cells, then that blood moves on into your veins. So the atrium, the arteries are oxygen rich. They have the oxygen in the blood when they go out from the heart. The capillaries is where your body is going to like get rid of the oxygen from the blood and give it to the organs. And then your veins is where that's the blood that doesn't have that much oxygen. It's already depleted its oxygen. It's heading back to the heart so that it can go to the lungs. Was there a question? I thought I heard something. Okay. So here it is, a diagram that shows how I was just talking. You have your inferior and superior vena cava. Your inferior and superior vena cava are going to dump into your right atrium. Your right atrium is going to then move the blood down into your right ventricle. and your right ventricle is going to shoot that blood into your pulmonary arteries. The blood will go from the pulmonary arteries into the lungs where they'll pick up oxygen. Then they'll come back through the pulmonary veins. They'll go into the left atrium, down into the left ventricle, and out into the body. So just keep that in mind. Blood comes in through the superior and inferior vena cava. That blood, since it's in the veins, doesn't have a lot of oxygen. It's going to go into the right atrium, to the right ventricle, to the pulmonary arteries, where it will go to the lungs. And the lungs is going to get oxygen, come back to the pulmonary veins, go down into the left atrium, then the left ventricle, and then out to the body. One thing I wanted to show you, though, so you see the aorta coming up here. And that aorta is coming up out of the left ventricle. And then that aorta is really large, and it has all these parts that's going to come off. You can see some of the parts coming off here at the top. It loops around the heart and then starts going down. But you also see that there are other arteries coming off of the vena cava, the aorta, which go around the heart. So these are called your coronary arteries. You can see here in this diagram your right coronary artery. You can see your left coronary artery. And then there's another coronary artery that really helps to feed your heart. So your heart needs oxygen and blood as well. If one of these arteries around your heart gets blocked off, then that's going to limit how much blood your heart can get. And then that's going to limit the amount of oxygen. And then can it work well with the low oxygen? This is just another diagram that continues to show what we just discussed. Superior vena cava, right atrium, right ventricle, pulmonary artery, goes to the lungs, comes back by pulmonary veins, left atrium, left ventricle, and then out to the aorta to go to the body. So as I said earlier, cardiovascular disease is an umbrella term for all types of diseases of your heart and blood vessel. So if it involves your heart and your blood vessels, that's cardiovascular disease. If it's just your heart, then that's heart disease. And heart disease is a catch-all phrase for a variety of problems that affects the heart structure, but it's specific to just the heart. And then, as I just mentioned, you have arteries that go around your heart, the right coronary artery, the left coronary artery, and then there's a descending coronary artery. If you have coronary artery disease, that is when we're talking about there's a problem with those arteries that feed the heart. You might have blockages that are starting to occur there. And that's another kind of heart disease. Now, why is it important for us to talk about heart disease? It might surprise you. I would admit that it even surprised me a little. That even when COVID was going on, in the first year of COVID, in the second year of COVID, you heard so much about, oh, COVID's happening. We had to lock down. You couldn't go anywhere. But COVID was still not the number one cause of death in the United States, even at any point in the coronavirus pandemic. The number one cause of death in the United States remained heart disease. Heart disease was the number one cause of death in 2019. It was the number one cause of death in 2020. It was the number one cause of death in 2021. I would bet you dollars to donuts that it's going to be the number one cause of death in 2022, and 2023. As long as I've known, coronary artery disease, a heart disease has been the number one cause of death for all men and women in the United States. 1 in 4 African Americans die of heart disease. 1 in 4. So that's 25% of African Americans are dying of heart disease each year. The death rate from heart disease is 24% higher for African American men and 26% higher for African American women of all ages than for whites. And among African Americans aged 25 to 44, 25, right? So this isn't something that just happens in your 70s and 80s. I just came back, as I said, I was in Savannah And, you know, we had an event there called Spirit of the Heart. We're going to have it in Orange County as well. And the MC was this young woman that was talking, you know, she was the MC for the event. And she shared a story, like she's in her early 40s. And she said one of her high school sweetheart, he died at age 48 from a heart attack. So this is something that's occurring even in younger ages, right? So we got to help our community understand that it's so important to make sure that we educate about the risk factors of heart disease so that we can prevent these heart attacks from happening. And we also have to figure out how to make changes because, unfortunately, African-Americans are more likely to die from heart attacks than any other group that's out there. If you take all the other groups, Asians, Hispanic, you know, Mexican, whatever else, African Americans have a higher death rate. So we got to figure out how do we help our community to change these numbers and statistics. So during this course, we want to help you to understand the facts about heart disease, right? A heart attack or a stroke may happen suddenly, but the truth is that heart disease happens over many years. Even though the heart attack came on at age 50, age 60, age 70, the fact is that our lifestyle had kept us leading up to that heart attack. The way we lived, the fact that we weren't paying attention to our diets, the fact that we weren't getting enough exercise, the fact that, you know, we were eating salty foods, all of that contributed to that heart attack happening when it ultimately happens. So what we have to do is recognize that and say that, hey, we can make changes to our diet, we can exercise, and we can do those things to stop heart attacks from happening. Heart attacks often begins when we're very young. So very early on in life, we start this process of developing those risk factors that put us at risk for heart attacks later. You know, in medical school, you were able to see like the fatty streaks in the arteries, even of young people in their teens. You know, so very early on, these fatty streaks start to develop. And that's because of our diet. That's because we're not getting enough exercise. And that's because of other factors. We also recognize that stress and anxiety play a role in heart attack as well. Stress and anxiety can trigger your arteries to tighten. So you get stressed, you release this cortisol, and that's going to put your body in this mode that, hey, that fight or flight response you may have heard about. And that's going to cause your arteries to tighten. And that can raise your blood pressure and put you at risk for heart disease as well. Preventing heart disease is important at all ages. So it's not just for individuals that are in their 20s or their 30s. And, you know, a lot of individuals in their 20s or 30s, they're not even thinking about heart attack, right? They're young, you know, they're in the prime of their lives. They're not thinking about, you know, they eat the fast foods. They don't get as much exercise, and that's putting them at risk. But it's not just for that 40 and 50 and 60 year old either. We need to also help our young children, because diabetes and obesity is starting to happen younger and younger in the United States. And so we have to figure out how to make those changes. So preventing heart disease is important at any age, just like maintaining your car. So, you know, you got that new car, you want to keep the engine running well. You know, you take it for its maintenance. You make sure the tires are properly punched, properly inflated. You need to do the same thing for your body. You need to make sure that you're taking in those foods that help you to be healthy so that you don't have a heart attack. And this course is going to teach us how to do that. So there are several factors for heart attacks, for cardiovascular disease. Some of these factors you can't control. One of the factors, age, and I can't control that I'm 51 years old. You know, I'm fortunate in it. I live to be 51 years old, but I can't control that. And that's a risk factor for cardiovascular disease. Another risk factor is gender. You know, as a man, I'm exposed to testosterone. My hormones are a little different. So that makes me more susceptible to cardiovascular disease. My gender do. Men are more susceptible to cardiovascular disease. I can't change my race. You know, I'm African-American. So because of that, there are some risk factors that are associated with being African-American. A lot of those risk factors are associated with our diet and exercise, right? But there are some also that are specific to our race. And then, of course, there's family history. My mother, she actually died from complications related to diabetes. She had diabetes. And my brother has diabetes now. So because my mother and my brother and other family members had diabetes, I'm more, I have a greater chance of getting diabetes as well. So these are factors, though, that I can't control. I have no control over them whatsoever. I can't control my age. I can't control my gender. I can't control my race, or can't control my family history. But there are other factors that I can control. I can control diabetes. So you might say, well, hey, but if I have diabetes, how can I, you know, you can control it. You can make sure you keep your sugar balanced. You can make sure you keep your sugar well-maintained, your A1C. We're going to talk about that. You might have seen it on television. Oh, my A1C is at this goal. You know, we can control, we have some control over our diabetes. We have control over our high cholesterol. You know, we can change our diets. We can also take medications such as statins for our cholesterol. We can control our drinking, right? You don't have to drink at all. There's no real reason that you have to have alcohol. You'll hear people say, oh, well, like drinking grape, drinking wine is good for you. But no, it's not the wine. It's what's in the grapes that's good for you. So you can eat grapes. You know, you don't have to drink alcohol. And so that's something that you can control. Your physical inactivity. You know, we can control whether we get outside and exercise or whether we sit around like couch potatoes. That's something that's within our control. Being overweight. Now, it's hard to control being overweight. You know, we get into that lifestyle and we say, oh, well, I can't lose it. And it's difficult. But even though it's difficult, it's still under our control. Having high blood pressure, we can control for that. Not getting enough sleep, smoking, and then the stress that's in our life. Sometimes the stress, yeah, it might seem like it's uncontrollable stress. But the fact is, we can look at strategies to start controlling our stress. So keep in mind, and as you talk to your community members, let them know that there are factors that you can't control. And then there are factors that you can control. So the risk factors that we can control include diabetes, include drinking, include high blood pressure, high cholesterol, physical activity, inactivity, lack of sleep, sleep apnea, being overweight, smoking, stress. These are all factors that we can control, that we have control over. Even though it's difficult, we have control over. So what you want to do when you talk to your community members is you want to go over this sheet. This is going to be in your manual to evaluate, are you at risk for heart disease? And so you'll make copies of these handouts, you'll give it to your community members, and then you'll go over it with them. These are the risk factors and traits or habits that make a person more likely to have heart disease. So go through the list and then check off the ones they have. I'll do this for myself right now. I would put a check by being overweight. You know, I hate to admit it, but yes, I'm maybe like 15 pounds overweight. So I need to lose weight. That's one of the risk factors for heart disease. Now, I'm being overweight doesn't mean I have heart disease, but it means that I have a risk factor for heart disease. So as we go through these, you're going to learn that, okay, having this risk factor doesn't mean that it's going to happen. Having this risk factor means that you are at a greater risk that heart disease can happen to you. So you want to try to control those risk factors. And for me, being overweight is one of those risk factors. I don't have high blood pressure. I check my blood pressure often. I do take a medication because I do have sickle cell disease. And so I take the medication to help my kidneys with the sickle cell disease. But it's also a medication that's used to control blood pressure. That helps to keep my blood pressure down as well. But I've never been diagnosed with high blood pressure. I've never been diagnosed with high cholesterol. I've never been diagnosed with diabetes. Now, I do have a family history of diabetes. And so we're going to talk a little later about having family history of it also puts you at risk. But I personally haven't been diagnosed with diabetes. I hate to admit that I am physically inactive. I work a lot. You know, I get up. When I'm not working, sometimes I'm checking like the stock market, see what's going on. Lately, I've been crying and stressed about it. So I need to stop looking at the stocks. But I haven't been as physically active as I need to be. So I would have to put a check that I'm physically inactive. And then my diet isn't healthy. I mean, so I don't know on the West Coast, I imagine you have like some chicken places. Over in the East Coast, we have this chicken restaurant called Popeye's Chicken. And I just love it. It's so good. But I try to avoid it, but I do admit that I love eating Popeye's chicken. So my diet is not healthy. I don't smoke though. So of these risk factors up top, I have three. I have overweight, physically inactive, and then a unhealthy diet. Now, let's look at some of the other ones. And then these are factors that I cannot control, right? I am age 51. So I'm older than the 45 here. And then for men, it's older than 45 is a risk factor. For women, older than 55 is a risk factor. The reason that it's different for men and women is because you have something called estrogen. And estrogen has been found to be a little protective. However, we're learning more and more that women are having heart attacks at younger age, particularly African-American women are really starting to have a lot of heart attacks at younger ages. And the problem there is that your symptoms can present differently. So it's important that you recognize that you could be at risk of having a heart attack. You could be having a heart attack. It's not going to be the same as the one that I would have. So mine might be, oh, my chest hurts. Yours must just be, oh, I got a little bit of gas, you know. And you might think it's just a little bit of gas, but actually could be signs and symptoms of heart attacks. You know, there's been an increase in African-American women having heart attacks at younger ages. That's one of the things that the ABC is looking at right now. And there are a number of risk factors that are starting to come to light right now. Like there's a lipoprotein little A that, you know, hadn't been talked about in the past. We're going to talk about it in this course. We really want you to know about it, because that's a risk factor for heart disease, lipoprotein little A. And we're going to talk about other risk factors as well. But you want to know that these are those risk factors that you can't control. So you can't control your age and then family history. As I mentioned, my mother had diabetes. She died from complications related to diabetes. She was in her 60s. You want to make sure you understand and you know your family history, because that can be a risk factor for cardiovascular disease. Now, I'm not going to go through all of this right now. When you teach this out in the community, though, it is important that you go through it. If I were to go through everything in the manual, the way it's supposed to be taught, but each session could take an hour and a half or longer. Some of the sessions that I said, hey, I want to teach it in person, you know, it really gets down into diabetes, really gets down into high blood pressure, and then cholesterol. You know, we're going to go through them fairly quickly. But when you do it in the community, you really want to go over these items so that community members understand them. So it's important that before you go out to teach the manual, you go through it so that you understand what's in it. And then you also go through it, you know, plan out your time so that you have enough time to explain everything to them. So here you can see the risk factors, high blood pressure. High blood pressure, you'll also hear the term hypertension. And it's called a silent killer. And we're going to go over that in more detail when we get to the high blood pressure session. You know, high blood pressure is when the blood pressure stays high for a period of time. It can cause serious heart problems, serious problems to your body. High blood pressure makes your heart work harder, right? Because the pressure in your arteries, you know, it's like it's clamping down. Your heart has to pump even harder to get that blood to go out of into the aorta, into the rest of your body. Untreated high blood pressure can lead to strokes, which you'll call brain attacks, can lead to heart attacks, problems with your eyes and your kidneys, and even death. Here you can see cholesterol is another risk factor. You want to go over these with your community members. Our body needs some cholesterol in order for it to work properly. We're going to learn about low-density lipoproteins, high-density lipoproteins. I was just telling you about another lipoprotein called lipoprotein little A. And that is something that we need to start educating our community members about, because we're just starting to learn about it, and it's a really significant risk factor for cardiovascular disease. We're going to learn about the proper levels, the healthy levels for cholesterol, LDL cholesterol, HDL cholesterol. So we know that healthy total cholesterol is less than 200 milligrams per deciliter. A healthy LDL level, low density lipoprotein, that's a lousy lousy cholesterol. We want to keep that one low. You want to keep it less than 100 milligrams per deciliter. And then your HDL, we want to keep our HDL higher. We want to try to get that elevated. So we want to get it above 40 milligrams per deciliter. But you're going to learn more about these risk factors. High blood pressure is a risk factor for heart disease. High cholesterol is a risk factor for heart disease. Yes, you have a question?
Yes, I do. I think you're doing a great job going through these. What does the MG/DL stand for?
Yes, yes. And MG/DL, we're covering it on the cholesterol chart, is milligrams per deciliter. And it's a measure of milligrams per deciliter. Any other questions?
Per okay. Deciliter, you said?
Deciliter, yes.
Thank you.
Okay. And we'll go over that more in the cholesterol section, okay. Milligrams per deciliter. It's just a unit of measurement of how much cholesterol is in a certain amount of certain amount of substance.
Okay. And you said LDL is lousy cholesterol. What would you say is HDL?
Healthy cholesterol. You want to keep it high. Okay. So we're going to learn an acronym later. LDL is lousy cholesterol. It likes to deposit the cholesterol into your arteries, okay. Right? So you want to keep it low. LDL likes to deposit, throw it into your arteries. You want to keep that one low. HDL, it kind of takes it. Now, it doesn't take it when it's down embedded into that artery. It can't get it out, but it helps to like make sure that it doesn't go into that. So you want to make sure you have higher HDL levels.
Wonderful. Thank you.
And we're also going to learn about another cholesterol. It's not in the manual, but there's lipoprotein little a. That's another type of cholesterol that's really bad. And we need to start figuring out how to get more women, African-American women, screened for it. So there are ways, though, to measure your blood pressure. We're going to teach you that. And then there are ways to measure your cholesterol levels. Usually that's done by screening. There are things that can influence your triglyceride levels, and we're going to go over that in the cholesterol session. Now, here are other risk factors. We're going to talk about being overweight. So in the manual, so you might notice that each of these risk factors that we're talking about, there are going to be sessions in the manual. There's the high blood pressure session. That's session 4. We have the cholesterol session. I believe that's session 6. We have a session on being overweight and obese. And we're going to go over what BMI, body mass index, and what that is and how we determine body mass index. There's diabetes is another risk factor. This is a really significant risk factor is diabetes. And diabetes is just when you have blood sugar, also called your blood glucose, is too high. We're going to go over that. As I mentioned, my mother and my brother, my mother passed away from complications related to diabetes. My brother has diabetes. He's already started having complications with his feet. So we're going to talk about that. And then physical activity. You know, there's a certain amount of physical activity we should have each day. We should be getting 30 minutes of physical activity each day. And we're going to talk about that as we go through the manual. Now, smoking is one that I would say is a significant risk factor that you can definitely control. If you smoke, please do everything you can to stop. Because there's no good reason to smoke, and all it's doing is being bad for your health. If you don't smoke, then please don't start at all. And when we talk about smoking, we're not just talking about cigarettes. You know, of course, cigarettes is a big one. Also, you know, a lot of people think, oh, if I have these e-cigarettes or I have a water pipe or something else, it's still tobacco smoke that's getting into your lungs. So it's still very bad for you. So no matter what form it's in, use of tobacco, use of smoking is bad for you. Even the e-cigarettes, even the water pipes, the shishi. You know, all of those things are bad for you. Sleeping problems. This isn't discussed enough. Unfortunately, we will not talk a lot about sleeping problems in this manual, but it is important to recognize that we need to get a good night's sleep. And, you know, not getting a good night's sleep can lead to, it can be one of those risk factors for cardiovascular disease. So we need to start figuring out how do we incorporate sleeping into it. And then, of course, stress. Stress plays a huge role in that it causes your body to release chemicals that causes those arteries to tighten down. It does that because your body is like a fight or flight response, right? You got to make sure, hey, you can move. So your body's going to clamp down so that blood can get to the organs real fast, get down to the legs and into the muscles where it needs to be used. But, you know, if you stay in that condition where you're always tightening down because your stress levels are always high, well, that can lead to cardiovascular issues. That can lead to problems in terms of a heart disease. So we need to figure out how we manage stress. And that might include not just talking to your doctor, family, and friends, but also talking to your church and doing other things to really help address your stress levels. The more risk factors you have, so we went over all of those risk factors for cardiovascular disease. As I pointed out, I had three risk factors in that top of the risk factors I can control. I'm overweight, you know, I have a poor diet, and I'm not getting enough exercise. There was also those risk factors that were at the bottom. You know, I'm 51 and I'm a male, as well as, you know, I have a family history of heart disease. I have significant reasons to make sure that I'm watching or controlling my heart disease. Unfortunately, I know that I don't have high blood sugar. I know that my blood pressure runs around 120 over 70. You know, I know. So this chapter is about knowing. You have to know. I know what my risk factors are. I know where I stand right now in terms of those numbers. That helps me in terms of knowing what I need to do to improve my care. Now, I know that I need to eat better. I know that I need to exercise, and I'm working on those things. But we need to help our community members understand and appreciate that they need to know their risk. They need to know if they have a family history of it. They need to know if they have these other risk factors like obesity, diabetes, high blood pressure. And then they need to figure out how to take steps for those. So in the manual, there is an activity called My Family History. And we won't do this today. You will do this with your group and with the people that you work with. And then maybe every session you want to check up on, hey, were you able to learn about your family history? Some people may have difficulty finding out about their family history. They know that, hey, oh yeah, my grandmother died at age 59, but I can't remember what it was. Well, you know, you want to encourage the people that you're working with to try to look into it some, to try to find out as much as they can about their family history, because that helps them to understand if they're at risk for some of these complications. So your family history can give you information about your own health. The fact that I know that my mother died from diabetes, you know, that's something that helps me to think, okay, I need to watch out for diabetes. I know that my grandmother also, she died from complications related to high blood pressure. So I know that I need to watch out for these things. Knowing your own family history will help you to take the actions to control your risk for heart disease and stroke. If you don't know many or any, because there are some people, unfortunately, that may not know any of their family history, if your blood relatives or they died, you can still learn about your family risk factors for heart disease through other methods and through other strategies. So as I said, when I first started, you know, we're going to talk about the Harris family. And here is the Harris family's family history. So at the very beginning, I introduced you to Miss Diane Harris. She's the mother of the person that's in this. She would be like the grandmother to many of the participants, many of the family members. So she's age 63 years old. She's still alive, but she has diabetes, high blood pressure. So we know that because Miss Diane Harris has diabetes and high blood pressure, her children, right, are going to have high blood pressure. So this family history belongs to Kayla. Kayla is the star of our show, and she's 37 years old. She's the daughter of Miss Diane. Her father died, but she knows that her father died from high blood pressure and he also smoked. He died of a heart attack at age 55, right? Miss Kayla also has an uncle who also has diabetes and high blood pressure. So you can see that diabetes and high blood pressure are pretty significant aspects of the family history of the Harris family. So you'll go through and you want to be able to use something similar to this for not only yourself, but also the people that you're going to work with. Talking to family members about the risk for heart disease, sometimes family members, they don't want to talk about this thing. It might be embarrassing. It's uncomfortable. Who wants to talk about how their mother died, right? So it might be difficult to broach the conversation and share that information sometimes. Some of the tips may include, though, and there's a sheet in the manual. This sheet here is in the manual. But taking this and then maybe doing it for your family, going through and then engaging your aunts, your uncles, your cousins, your siblings on filling this out. And that might make it a little easier for them to talk about it. You want all of the other your family members to know about their risk too. So sharing this information with them can also help them to live a healthier lifestyle. So you wanna also tell them about the course. Talk to your family about the course, members about the course, teach the course in your community so that we can help individuals live longer, healthier lives. So just to wrap up and review what we talked about today in this session, we talked about the risk factors for heart disease. And we talked about how there are some risk factors that we can't control. I cannot control my age. I cannot control my sex. I cannot control, when I say sex, I mean my gender. I cannot control my race, and I cannot control my family history. But there are a lot of things that we can control. And that's what we're going to talk about in this manual. I can control my overweight, being overweight. I can control my physical inactivity, my blood pressure, my cholesterol, diabetes, smoking, unhealthy diet, not eating well. I can control the stress. I can control the sleep apnea. And I can control the fact that I'm not getting enough sleep. So in future sessions, what we're going to do in the next session and then moving forward, we're going to talk about those strategies, because this book is all about teaching strategies to our community members to start controlling some of these, to start figuring out how do I reduce my blood pressure by reducing the amount of salt that I eat and so on. So that's the end of session one. I do know that I went through it very quickly, but do you have any questions at the moment? Yes.
So when you shared the BMI numbers,
yes,
I have heard there's some discrepancy on the optimal BMI for Black people because of the makeup of our body structure on average versus yes. white people. How would we address that type of question?
Yes. So the biggest one is that it's a misconception. That the BMI was created and it takes into account, the only group that it doesn't work for is the Asian population. And it doesn't work for them because they tend to be smaller. So their BMI, they're going to be smaller according to the BMI chart because they're just smaller. But African-Americans, whites, Hispanics, what I often say is that if you go back and if you watch old episodes of Soul Train, all of them look skinny, right?
Uh-huh.
Our perception has changed. We're used to seeing ourselves and seeing others around us big. And so because of that, we do come up with excuses that, hey, everybody else is big. This can't be right, But the fact of the matter is that it is right. We should be a lot smaller than we are. Wow. But because of our diets, because of our lifestyles, we eat a lot, but we don't exercise. We don't walk. We don't do, we have changed over the years. So people will say, oh, my grandmother, they'll often say my grandmother used to eat all this fatty foods and she lived to be 98, but she walked everywhere she went, right? They didn't have as many cars and her lifestyle was different than ours. So my grandmother was a really petite woman. She was very thin. I'm sure her BMI would be like what you would consider normal. But unfortunately, And all of us are guilty of this. The United States, you know, we kind of took to heart that motto, go big or go home. You know, we gotta start like make sure we're downsizing, you know, moving forward. But yeah, you'll get that a lot. And the fact of the matter is that the BMI is correct for whites and blacks. Any other questions? Now, do you all feel like you need to take a break? I can take a short one if you need, but if you don't, then we can move forward.
I think you're on a roll. For me, I'd say
okay. Okay. Well, I'm going to do one quick thing before I go into the next session. And I am going to teach the next session. I'm going to probably speed it up just a bit so that I can get you out on time. As I mentioned, when you teach it out in the community, I want you to, like, you know, think about how you're going to teach it, but go through all of the, you know, I skipped all of the skits that they have, the role plays, the other things. I encourage you to do those, incorporate those into your training when you do it out in the community. We can't do it on this. You know, we'd be here like 2 hours for one session if we were doing that. And I know that you all don't want to spend that much time with me. So, you know, I'm teaching it pretty quickly. I want you, though, to slow it down in the community. Interact with them. Ask them questions. Let them answer the questions. And make it more engaging than I am doing. And so, as I said, I do apologize that it's not as engaging. I want to just real quickly, I'm going to do this, share my screen. Because I'm teaching it with slides. But you're going to have the With Every Heartbeat Is Life manual. I believe everybody should have the link so that you can get to this. So I'm going to stop sharing. I'm going to show you how I got here, if I can. Let me see if I can share my screen. And then go to, give me 1 second. I'm going to see if I can go through it. And then if you can see my screen while I'm going through it. Give me a second. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So you should have a link that I sent to you. And if you don't have the link, let me know. The link is going to take you to here. So this is the National Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute's. This is where they have the information on the With Every Heartbeat Is Life manual. So it'll take you here. And then if you push manual, it will download the manual for you, right? So you can then go in here and then you'll have the manual that will come up. Now, this is the electronic version of the manual. We're going to bring you a hard copy of it as well, but you have the electronic version of the manual. And if you were to scroll down so you can see all of the sessions, you know, we did session one just now, knowledge is power, know your risk for heart disease. We're going to do session two next, reactive time for heart attack size. But if you were to go down, then in the manual, it has everything that I just covered. Let's go down to session one. So this is session one right here. And as I, you know, you saw me start with that quote from Jesse Jackson. And then when you get down into it, you're going to want to read before you go in and teach the sessions. But when you get down to the meat of the session, you will have this the participants want, won't have it. But it will tell you everything that you need to say. I want to start this discussion with a quote from Jesse Jackson. You know, then you'll go through these classes will prepare you to make lifestyle changes that are healthy. Then I talked about heart disease is the number one cause of death in the country. The National Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute has created the With Every Heartbeat Is Life manual. Knowledge is power. Knowing your risk for heart disease can encourage you to do something about it. So it gives you everything that you need to say and then everything that you need to do as well. Because it'll say, it'll tell you to ask the audience questions and give them a few minutes, right? So you'll ask, what does the quote mean to you about the Jesse Jackson quote? And I asked you that. I went ahead and responded because we don't have time, but you want to ask them that and engage them. When you get down here, it'll tell you things that you can do. So, you know, how to do the manual, you know, then it'll say, put the names of these on the chalkboard. So going through all of the different sessions of the manual. And then, so I just wanted you to know that the manual gives you everything that you need to say and everything that I'm saying it's grounded in this manual. With the slides I might have made, it's everything. I don't say everything that's in here, but with the slides, it has all of the information that comes from here. And it's important because we want you to follow the manual when you teach it out in the community. You know, follow the manual. Don't, you might get questions about, like I just got asked, what about BMI? And you'll get those questions, but you'll just say, hey, BMI, as far as we know the science, it's the same for Blacks and whites. Unfortunately, our perception is what has changed over the years because we're so used to seeing things larger now that we think that, hey, being large is normal. But it's really not. If we go back and we look at some of those African-Americans, like I was saying in Soul Train and in other movies from the back in the 50s, they're very thin. And so then I went through the heart is an amazing part of the body and a single day it'd be. So everything you need to say, I just wanted to point this out, is in the manual. And so I just wanted you to know that. I wanted to share that with you. I'm not going to teach from the manual today, but it's there. Yes.
Excuse me. So you're out in the community teaching 12 sessions? Is that, that's the question I wanted to ask you, but I'm going to bring it up now so I don't have to contact you.
Yes. So what we want to do is we want to encourage you to teach at least one session out in the community per month. And if you did at least one session out in the community per month, you'd get through 10 sessions. There are two sessions in the manual that you don't need to teach. That they're there to deal with like evaluation and so forth. So session 11 and session 12, you don't need to teach those out in the community. But we want you to teach sessions 1 through 10. And 1 through 10 are on those risk factors for heart disease. We want you to teach at least one session per month. If you can do that. And we recognize that's a huge ask. But you can look at doing things like, maybe taking a sheet from the manual and talking about it. So there are some sheets on high blood pressure. And maybe like during your church ministry, you can say it's important to control for high blood pressure and giving the audience strategies for reducing their salt intake and for being screened for high blood pressure, What we need to do, if we're serious about making change in our community, about preventing deaths early, we got to figure out how we get that knowledge into the community. And so I want to work with you to try to figure that out. I know it's a huge ask. I'm asking you to do, 10 sessions in a year, but that's what our ask is that you would commit to that.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Yes, I have a follow-up question to that. So what would be an effective sized group? Are we shooting for, 8 to 10 participants, or are you visualizing we should be looking at, 20 to 25 or so?
So I would say, it would depend a lot on what you see as an effective group. So 8 to 10 could be a very effective group, right? If you can get them coming back constantly and you're working with them, then that's wonderful. That's 8 to 10 lives that you're saving, right? Now, if you're starting to teach the manual, it could be a lot to do it with the large class. So I would say try not to do like more than 25. If you want to go up to 20, 25, but I say that with depending on what you do, because you could take a sheet from the manual, as I was saying, and just read it out in the church, right? And that could be 100 people or more that you're then talking to. It's difficult to engage with 100 people though. So we do want you to think about how you can have small classes that allows you to engage, allows you to do some of these activities. Because if you're teaching like 25, 30, 35, getting all of them engaged is gonna be difficult. Getting them to participate in some of the, like when you have the role plays or skits, that can be difficult if you have 25 or more people. But it depends on how you, and we'll talk to you about strategies, because what we want you to do is educate your community, educate your congregation about the risk factors for heart disease. I'm gonna go off camera for just 1 second as I just take a sip of water.
Thank you.
Okay, we have any other questions? And then please feel free to ask me later. It looks like we haven't had too many. Was there anyone that joined us after I read the roll? Like I did not call your name earlier, or you weren't there when I was calling names. I think Janet yes. Webb.
Karen Heard.
Karen, okay. Let me make sure I put you down.
You called my name.
Okay. Okay, I got you. Yes. So let me just see.
Glenice Williams.
Yes, yes, I got yours, Ms. Williams. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. I think I have everyone's name here now that was here earlier. Okay, I got you. So I'm going to go ahead and just get started. Just a minute.
Did you get me for Joyce Moore?
Joyce Moore.
Yeah.
Yes, I believe I had you.
Okay, thank you.
Oh, no, I didn't have you. You're right. Okay, I got you now.
Okay.
Okay, I think I got everybody now. I didn't have you earlier. I got you now, though. Okay, so let me go ahead and pull up the next session. And as I said, when you teach this out in the community, you know, you may use the slides if you're teaching it virtually, but you also may just do it. So I make sure I'm pulling up the right slides. Just do it like face-to-face. And when you do that, I'm going to show you how I do it face-to-face, because there are also some demonstrations that you may want to include when you're doing the manual. Okay. So this next session that we're going to talk about is reacting time for heart attack signs. Reacting time for heart attack signs. Okay. So Charles Chestnut once said, there's time enough, but none to spare. So in this session, so you would want to ask your community members, what does that mean to you? There's time enough, but none to spare. And what I would think that it means, so, you know, because we're talking about heart attacks, is that when someone is having a heart attack, you know, you probably heard the expression, time is muscle, because every minute that's passing by, part of their heart is being destroyed or being damaged or dying because it's not getting the oxygen it needs. So in the last session, we talked about the structure of the heart and how the heart itself has these coronary arteries. And if one of those coronary arteries are blocked off, that can lead to a heart attack. And if that happens, that means that heart muscle is not getting the oxygen it needs, is not getting the nutrient it needs, and as a result, it's starting to die. So as I mentioned, Charles Chestnut, and if you didn't know, Charles Chestnut was a writer from the late 1800s to early 1900s. And he said that quote, so if you have a symptoms of a heart attack, the sooner you can get help, the better. Heart attacks can seriously damage your heart and can even be fatal. That's why it's important to know the warning signs of a heart attack and to do make sure that you're doing what you need to do if you start having symptoms of a heart attack. So in this session, we're going to talk about the warning signs of a heart attack and the importance of acting quickly if you or someone else has those warning signs. By the end of the session, you should know some of the basics about how the heart functions. So we went over how the heart functions, what a heart attack is, why people may delay getting help for a heart attack, the benefits of calling 911, steps you can take now to help you survive a heart attack, and then how to prepare your emergency card. So in the manual, there's an emergency card that you can make a copy of and give out to your participants when you teach the session. Okay, So the facts don't lie. And you'll see, like, the facts don't lie at the beginning of most of these sessions. And it usually talks about the fact that, hey, we know that this is a serious problem. And we also know that it's a problem that disproportionately affects African Americans. So the facts don't lie. In the United States, someone has a heart attack every 40 seconds. Mm. So, you know, I've been teaching this class now for about an hour and 18 minutes. So we say there's 60 minutes in an hour. You know, 80 people have had a heart attack since I've been teaching the course. Of those who die, about half of them do so within an hour of their first symptoms. So usually you'll have that first symptom, I have a little bit of chest pain. And half of those individuals that start complaining that chest pain, they're having a heart attack, they're going to die within an hour. So it's important to recognize what those symptoms are so that you can take the steps to get help very quickly. And they usually die before they reach the hospital. I mentioned earlier that I was in Savannah. The former mayor of Savannah was in our program. And he said that while he was a mayor, he was in his, I think he was in his 50s at the time. He said he was at a mayor's conference in Memphis, Tennessee. And he felt a pain, but he said he kept the wherewithal to call 911. He said he was fortunate that he didn't pass out, because if he would have passed out, then it would have been a situation where they would have just found his body the next day, because he wouldn't have been able to get the help. He would have died. I don't have all of the story, but he said that they had to go in and three of those coronary arteries were blocked. And so they had to go in and put stents in three of those coronary arteries. So he came close to dying. He presented at the conference we were having over the weekend. But it underlines the importance of knowing your risk factors for heart disease, knowing your risk factors for heart attack, but also knowing what to do if you start having symptoms of a heart attack. And it's also going to be important. It's discussed in this, I can't discuss it enough, that the heart attack symptoms for women may be significantly different than a heart attack symptoms for men. So as women, you need to know, you need to be in tune with your body to say that, hey, these are symptoms of a heart attack. Now, we also know, unfortunately, that African Americans are at higher risk of having a heart attack than other groups. They're also at much higher risk of dying from those heart attacks as other groups as well. So we talked about those arteries that surround the heart. And we know that normally blood flows freely and carries that oxygen to the heart through those arteries, so that coronary artery that we discussed. But this long tube here, it can be with any of the arteries, right? It can be the arteries going down to your legs. It can be the arteries going up to your arms. It can be arteries going up to your brain. But you have these arteries, and these arteries can get clogged with cholesterol and with plaques and with other things. And they can also clamp down because of stress. You have high blood pressure. And because of that, that's going to make the blood hard to flow. It's not going to make it through to get to the parts of the body, the parts of the heart. So certain risk factors for heart disease, like smoking, can damage blood vessels. So just the act of smoking, that smoking going into your artery, you know, that it doesn't just go down into your lungs. It gets into your bloodstream. It does all of this, and it can cause those vessels to be damaged. Plaque, which is a waxy substance, can also build up in your arteries where that damage has occurred. And so you get these plaques forming. In this diagram here is this yellow substance, that's the plaque that's building up. And that comes from, you know, cholesterol, it comes from damage that's related to smoking. It comes from damage related to high blood sugar. It comes from all those other risk factors that we said. But what can happen is that, you know, you have these plaques in your heart, they can rupture at some point. And when they rupture, then a clot can form on them, right? So the clot can form on the ruptured plaques, and then that can completely block off that blood flow that's in that artery. And then that's what's causing a heart attack, because now, you know, your blood flow has stopped here. It's not able to get to the tissues that's beyond that blockage, right? And so the tissues beyond that blockage, and as we said earlier, your heart has to pump 100,000 times a day, right? It has to pump 2,000 gallons of blood. And so now if it's not able to get that tissue, it's still trying to work. It's still trying to work. But now oxygen's not coming into it. It's not able to get the nutrients it needs. Those cells start dying, right? And then it's not going to be able to pump right. And so then you have a heart attack. If you don't get treatment to restore the blood flow. So, you know, we're going to talk in a few minutes about an angioplasty. That's where they take a balloon and they go in there and they blow it up. But if you don't get that done in very quickly, then eventually that heart tissue down here is going to die and your heart's going to fail. And that's going to lead to death. So it's very important. It's extremely important to call 911 at the first symptoms of a heart attack. If you have that chest pain, that pain in your arms, that dizziness, we're going to talk about some of the symptoms. It's important to call 911. Now, you want to call 911, you want to get to the hospital because they have clot busting drugs that they can use, right? They can give you things that's going to stop that clot. And then also you might have heard that taking an aspirin. And aspirin is also going to stop the clots from forming, right? So it can be very helpful that if you see somebody having a heart attack, to take an aspirin. Now, we're going to talk a little bit more about that. You know, some of the things have changed. You know, you don't necessarily want to give people aspirins. You know, you do. If they're having a heart attack, I would say give them an aspirin. You know, the recommendations are changing. Sometimes they're saying, hey, don't give them an aspirin because if you don't know their circumstances, if they're allergic to aspirin, it can make things worse. I will say, and I'm saying this as a doctor, that if you see someone having a heart attack, then give them an aspirin. But you want to call 911. Even after you give them that aspirin, you still want to call 911 because they need clot-busting drugs and they may need an angioplasty. So treatments for a heart attack have improved over the years. We've gotten better at recognizing a heart attack is happening and then doing things to really make sure that they get the treatment. Now we have treatments that can open up blood vessels and restore blood flow. We have those clot-busting medications, as I have up here. And these are drugs that help to dissolve the blood clot that's blocking the arteries. You must get these drugs, though, as soon as possible, within a few hours after the symptoms. There's also angioplasty. So angioplasty is where they're going to go into your wrist or into your femur here. They're going to send a needle, a catheter, up to where that blockage is. They're going to insert a balloon, and they're going to balloon is going to pop open and push that clot back open. And then that's going to restore blood flow. And then after it pushes it open, they're going to leave a stent behind. So we talked about the importance of getting those clot-busting drugs as soon as possible. And of having the angioplasty, having that insert a balloon, they open it up and then they can leave a stent. African-Americans and heart attacks. So unfortunately, people, particularly African-Americans, we often wait too long before we seek medical help for the warning signs of a heart attack. If you think that you or someone else is having a heart attack, don't ignore it or feel embarrassed to call 911. You got to get that emergency help. You can be dead within the hour if you don't get the help. But if you get that help, they can do things to open that clot up, to bust it open, put a stent in, and allow you to live long enough so that you're here for your grandchildren and your great-grandchildren if possible. So we want to make sure that you're calling 911, you're getting the help you need so that you can take care of yourself. So in the manual, you'll see that this is page 2.517. You know, you want to act fast. Call 911 as soon as you're having those warning signs. We're going to talk about what the warning signs of a heart attack are. And if you have them, then you want to act fast. You want to tell your family and friends about the warning signs and to call 911 right away. You want to ask your healthcare provider about what you can do to lower your risk for a heart attack and take those steps. And then in the manual on page 2.21, there's an emergency card. You want to give that to the participants, ask them to fill it out so that you're prepared ahead of time. You know, when the heart attack happens, that's not the time to get everything into place. You want to make sure that you're prepared for if something were to happen. So what might prevent you or your family members or others from calling 911? What are some of those things? You know, I'm not going to wait for an answer because I know that, you know, we're running a little bit behind right now and I need to catch up. But they may think, so individuals may think that, hey, the symptoms aren't bad enough. I don't want to, you know, be embarrassed with the ambulance outside. You know, I'll have a friend just drive me. That might be faster. You know, if a friend drives me to the hospital, the emergency personnel probably won't get here fast enough. You know, if you live in certain areas, hey, will they get here in time? And there's so many reasons that we make, even that, oh, well, it might be too expensive, right? So why should I call the ambulance? I can save a couple dollars. The fact is, by calling 911, you may be saving your life. So you want to make sure that you make sure you call 911. Whatever you do, don't drive to the hospital or let someone else drive you. Call an ambulance. Why wouldn't you want to drive yourself? Well, you could pass out on the way to the hospital, right? You could, that heart attack, now that caused me to pass out. Now you're putting other people's lives in danger as well, because you'll crash your car, end up crashing into someone, killing someone. So you definitely don't want to drive yourself. We're going to talk in a few minutes that you also don't want someone else to drive. Having the ambulance come is like having the emergency room come to your house. They can come out with those medications we talked about. They can't do the angioplasty. But they can do a lot of other things in between to help keep you alive, to help, you know, that heart tissue, help the heart, the situation. So you want to call an ambulance because they can start giving you care right away. That's one of the reasons you definitely want to call an ambulance. But whatever you do, don't ignore the symptoms. Don't have a friend drive you. And don't think some of these things. Now, as I mentioned, and it's in your manual, there's an emergency card. And you want to start planning ahead, you know, particularly if you have those risk factors for heart disease. You know, I'm 51. I'm up in age. You know, I have some other risk factors. As I mentioned, I'm overweight. I'm not physically active. So having this card is very important so that if something happened, I'm prepared. But what you have to remember is to call 911 is the most important thing that you can do when you or someone else you know is having a heart attack, because it's like bringing the emergency room to your front door. Now, what are the warning signs for a heart attack? A common warning signs. Now, I will say that this is not all inclusive, but it's the majority of the warning signs that you'll see. There could be other warning signs as well. One of the biggest ones that's not on this list that we're starting to see more often is just fatigue, that feeling tired. You know, women have that as one of their symptoms. And that might be the only symptom that they have, is that they feel, oh, I'm feeling tired. Well, that could be a sign of heart attacks. But the ones that we know most about, so, you know, I know that you're in California, with like Sanford and Son, they were in California, you probably remember. The father, Fred Sanford, he would always say, this is the big one, he'd grab his heart and indicate that he's having chest pain. So that's your most common symptom of a heart attack, is that chest pain. So chest pain or uncomfortable feeling of pressure, it feels like an elephant is sitting on your chest and squeezing on your chest. That's the most common symptom that you have. And that could last for a few minutes, or it could last for longer. It might feel like heartburn or indigestion. So that's one of the major symptoms for a heart attack. That's the one that we're all familiar with. But you can also have discomfort in one or both of your arms. So people might say, oh, my arm hurts here, my hand, my arm, just feel like there's a shooting pain down my arm. There's a shooting pain up into my neck and my jawbone. Those are hurt. So those are can be signs of a heart attack. That arm pain, neck pain, jaw pain, back pain. Also shortness of breath. So you just, oh my gosh, I feel like I can't catch my breath. That could be warning signs of a heart attack. Other ones include breaking out in a cold sweat, feeling lightheadedness or sudden dizziness, nausea, or feeling sick to your stomach. And this is one that could be common in women, that, oh, it just feels like I have a bit of gas or indigestion. Well, that could be signs of a heart attack. And then, as I mentioned, you know, one that we're seeing quite frequently now in women is just that fatigue, feeling unusually tired for no reason, sometimes for days, that could be signs of a heart attack, particularly in women. So, you know, most common sign of a heart attack, though, you know, we have to go back to what you will see often is that chest pain. That's the most common sign.
That's me, guys. I'm on a website doing the.
Okay. So, you know, the most common sign you're going to see is that chest pain, right? But that's not always the case, and it may feel different. So, as I mentioned, you know, it's not always like you see in the how it happens on in the movies or on TV. The fact that Fred Sanford and son, you know, Fred Sanford, that's not usually how it happens. You could be having different. It can be different for everyone. So we want to make sure that we're recognizing those symptoms. And even though it comes on suddenly, as we said, it feels like it's sudden. You know, heart attacks develop over time. Also, the symptoms can be slow in developing, and they could happen over hours, days, or weeks. So you could be walking around and, I've been having gas, or, you know, this feeling in my chest for 3 days. Well, you're having a heart attack. You know, some people have so few symptoms, though, that they don't know they're having a heart attack. So, you know, sometimes, and that's unfortunate, that you could be having symptoms and you're just not aware of it. So what do you think someone, and I cannot, what do you, I can't read because this thing is too, what do you think someone might not realize they're having a heart attack? Why do you think someone may not realize they're having a heart attack? You may confuse a heart attack with other symptoms such as indigestion. Some people don't have symptoms at all. So as I mentioned, unfortunately, they may not have symptoms. Heart attacks that occur without any symptoms or with very mild symptoms are called silent heart attacks. So you may not even be aware of it, unfortunately. And that's one of the reasons that it's important to know, connecting to a cardiologist, connecting to your doctor, so they can evaluate you for those risk factors, so they can know if steps need to be taken, because you could be one of those individuals having a silent heart attack. If you don't believe you're having a heart attack, you know, that could be another reason that they don't seek help. It's easy to ignore the warning signs. So, you know, right now, even as I sit here, you know, I had a big dinner, you know, my a little achy. I might say, it's not that bad. You know, it won't get worse. I think it's something else. So I'm not going to get help. But unfortunately, we have a lot of individuals that die because of that. So what do you want to do if you know someone is having a heart attack, or if you're having a heart attack? The first thing, you know, sit the person down. Let them rest, keep them calm, loosen their clothes, but make sure you call 911. Don't leave them except to call for help if necessary. Don't allow them to deny the symptoms. So it might be a situation where, you know, your husband is, I just got to sit down. I got a little bit of indigestion, not feeling well, a little bit of chest pain. I'll just rest and let it go away. And you may go back an hour or two later and he's passed away. So make sure that you don't let them just blow it off, that you get the help that they need. Don't allow them to deny the symptoms. Don't wait to see if the symptoms go away, and don't give the person anything by mouth unless they have a prescription. Of course, you also want to give them that aspirin is what I would recommend. So as we mentioned earlier, what are the benefits of calling 911? We know that emergency personnel can arrive quickly and begin diagnosis and treating. So they have things on their ambulance that they can start treatment right away, even before you get to the hospital. They can start hooking you up. They have that thing to start giving you air. They have a defibrillator on their on their truck. They have a lot of other things on their truck that they can help you with. So don't drive yourself to the hospital. You can't get that help if you're in a car. You know, don't drive yourself to the hospital. You might pass out and end up, you know, causing a worse situation for people. So make sure that you call 911, that ambulance can come and they can start treating you right away. On the way to the hospital, they can also call ahead to the emergency personnel, let them know. So, you know, you don't want to show up at the emergency room, you're having a heart attack, and then they say you tell you to fill out forms and wait in the waiting room. You know, if you're coming in on that ambulance or that 911, they're going to prepare ahead of time to make sure that they're ready to receive you. that they're ready to start treatment as soon as you hit the door, hopefully. So the ambulance is usually, it helps to save time there as well. And then also, as I mentioned, your heart may stop beating during a heart attack. So if you're driving in your car, your heart stops, then you're going to crash. You can kill yourself or you can kill someone else. Emergency personnel carry equipment to restart your heart. So they have a defibrillator that's on their truck that they can use if your heart were to stop in transit to the hospital. Emergency personnel or medical hospital staff, they are usually asked for an emergency contact person. So that's why you want to plan ahead. You know, that emergency card, you can fill that out ahead of time, have it with you, so that if you were to pass out, let's say somewhere, you're at the grocery store or you're at the mall and you pass out, having that emergency card that's in your manual will help them to understand what the situation is, who they need to contact, what medications you take, so that things can be taken care of. You also want to talk to your family and friends about the warning signs of a heart attack and the importance of calling 911 right away. You want your family and friends to know that, hey, this could happen. And if this happens, we need to get help right away. Call 911. Get that rescue squad out there. They can start working on you ahead of time. You should also talk to your healthcare provider. So you should also talk to your doctor. You know, they're going to be able to help educate you about your risk factors, but they can also tell you, hey, these are things that you can do to help if you have a heart attack. Hey, so maybe you're one of those persons, you're not allergic to aspirin. It's okay to take a baby aspirin should the need arise. That you can learn that ahead of time from your doctor. You can also learn other things that can help you if you get into a situation. You also want to encourage your family and friends to see their doctors. So that's something that as the ABC, we're going to stress, that we want everyone to have a primary care provider. We want everyone to have a doctor that they can call so that they can stay healthy. As I mentioned in the manual, so on page 49 in the manual is my emergency card. You want to make copies of that, hand that out to your participants, make sure that they're aware. Have them fill it out so that they have it just in case. And they want to prepare that ahead of time. It includes their name, relationships, phone numbers of people to call if they end up going to the hospital. So if something were to happen to you at the mall, you know, you would want your family members, you would want your friends to know. So there needs to be a contact way that something that they have, the emergency staff has, so that they can contact your closest relatives. You want to have emergency numbers in your area, so you want to keep numbers to 911, maybe to the local hospital. Make sure that your hospital has that, because not every hospital can do that angioplasty. So what you want to do is before you go out and you start teaching the manual, maybe you can do a little reconnaissance yourself, figure out which hospitals in my area are able to do that angioplasty, because not all of them are. You want to list other health problems that you may have. It's very important that the medical staff know, hey, does this person have diabetes? Does this person have high cholesterol? Does this person have a history of heart disease? Have they had a heart attack before? Those are all things that are important for the medical staff to know. They will also need to know, what kind of medications do you take? Do you already take heart medications? You know, they don't want to give you something that's going to lower your blood pressure too low. So they need to know, hey, is this person on blood pressure medication? What medications do they take? Any allergies? So as I mentioned, you know, unfortunately, some people are allergic to aspirin right now. You know, some, you might hear recommendations, oh, don't give them aspirin. But I would say if you see someone having a heart attack, give them aspirin. But you would want to list any allergies you may have and any important information that you feel is relevant to go on that sheet. And then you want to fill out that form and then keep it in your wallet. I think that is the end of my slides. So as I mentioned, I wanted to get through that pretty quickly. I actually got through it quicker than I thought I would. So is there any questions right now about either of the sessions, either session one, knowledge is power, or session two, reacting time for heart attack signs? Any questions?
Donnell, so session two is really about self-identifying a heart attack.
Yes.
Do you have any insight on being an observer of a potential heart attack and how to address that?
Yes. So as I mentioned, and you will hear, you know, with giving aspirins, they might say, well, you know, make sure, because you know, like if they're on nitroglycerin, for example, you know, you wouldn't give aspirin and nitroglycerin. If they have nitroglycerin, you just give that. But if they're having a heart attack and you don't know their family history, I would caution on the side of giving them an aspirin, because the aspirin stops the clotting, right? What's going on in the heart attack is that, you know, you've had these plaques develop. Those plaques can rupture, meaning that, you know, something happens in the plaque, the top of the plaque is ripped off. Once the top of the plaque is ripped off, then what's going to happen is your body's going to start sending platelets there to start clotting it up, because it's going to say, hey, oh, you're bleeding. It wants to stop the bleeding. That's the normal process. But in stopping the bleeding, they're actually blocking off blood flow. And you need to really stop that from happening. Aspirin can help you stop that, but then call 911. There's nothing that replaces calling 911 if you see someone having a heart attack.
And does a diabetic crisis look similar to a heart attack?
A diabetic crisis, now from my understanding, and I have to admit, I've seen a diabetic crisis when they've arrived at the hospital. Mm-hmm. I haven't seen one happen while it was happening. But a diabetic crisis, so depending, and we're going to talk about this later, when you say a diabetic crisis, it could be because they have too much blood sugar,
yeah,
right? So their hyperviscosity, that's going to stop the blood flow. It's going to slow it down. That could look more like a stroke, I would say, than a heart attack. A heart attack is that they're going to grab their chest, or they're going to complain about severe pain somewhere in their chest or in their arms. They're going to grab their arms and say, ah, you know, a diabetic crisis, I would imagine, is closer to them passing out. So it could look similar in the fact that, hey, they're passing out. You don't know why they passed out. In both cases, you want to call 911. You need to get those individuals help. If they're having it now, and so when I say a diabetic crisis, it could be because they have too much blood sugar. It could also be in a person, you know, when you say it like that, diabetic crisis, it also makes me think that if they have hypoglycemia.
Mm-hmm.
So individuals that are diabetic, they take insulin to try to control their diabetes. If they're taking insulin, but they're not eating enough,
right. So
they might skip a meal, that could drop their blood sugars too low. And then they can pass out because they have too low sugars. But I think that when you say diabetic crisis, that in my mind, it looks like they're passing out either because their blood sugar is too high or their blood sugar is too low.
That's good.
But we'll talk about diabetes later in another session.
I just encountered more people having a diabetic crisis because they took the medication before coming to church and didn't need anything.
Okay. So when you said like they had a diabetic crisis, what did that look like? Like what were the symptoms?
When I was brought in to the situation, some ushers had gotten them over to our chapel and was making them comfortable in a chair. I think they were trying to get them to lay down, and he didn't want us to call 911, and they ended up getting him some orange juice. But at that point, I don't know that that was the right thing to move him, you know, from the sanctuary into a different room. You know, if it was a heart attack, I'll wait, but that's what I've encountered.
Yes. And as I said, so I mean, part of it is knowing the history. The way you described it, it makes it sound like they kind of knew that, hey, this person was a diabetic, that and they may have had an encounter with them before, that they had hypoglycemia. So they're taking their insulin, but they're letting their blood sugars get too low, because that's what you would do. You'd give them orange juice if their blood sugar got too low. I would still, me personally, would caution on the side of calling 911, because we don't know what's happened, right?
Right.
And even now, you know, people ask me medical advice. There are tests that can be done to tell you what's happening. You know, without those tests, I can't tell you what is happening. I see a person passing out, it could be from a number of things. It could be a heart attack. And people with diabetes, they're at higher risk of heart attack. So just keeping that in mind.
Okay, thank you.
So the question is, why are baby aspirin given as opposed to regular aspirin? The reason is that the baby aspirin has the amount that's needed to stop the clotting from happening to help the blood flow. But some people, they do have, it's not an allergy to aspirin, but they could have like a GI problems. And you can get GI problems from aspirin. You can get hemorrhages from aspirin. And so you want to be careful because too much aspirin can lead to some of those GI upsets and those GI problems. But the baby aspirin has the amount that's needed to treat the heart attack without having those GI issues. And when I say GI, I'm sorry, I meant gastrointestinal. So some people, if they have ulcers or they have other gastrointestinal problems, those higher dose aspirin, the regular aspirins, can be a problem. Me personally, like I would avoid, so you do want to use the baby aspirin if it's having a heart attack. That's enough aspirin to treat the problem without being that too much aspirin to cause that gastrointestinal upset. So use the baby aspirin for heart attack. You know, me myself, I try to avoid taking aspirin because I have sickle cell disease. And aspirin can be hard on your kidneys. I don't want to, you all probably don't have to worry about that. You know, you don't have sickle cell. If you don't have renal problem, kidney problems, you know, you had to talk to your doctor about whether you can take aspirin. But some people just need to avoid taking aspirin. And baby aspirin is going to be enough to deal with the problem without causing some of those other problems. Let me see if are there any other questions in the chat. Okay. Someone said, I apologize, I can't. Okay. So that's okay. As I said before, we are recording these sessions. I'm going to try to find the way to get these on the site. I think I have everybody's contact information, your email address. So what I'll do is, and I can't promise you I'll have it up in the next week or two, but I'm going to try to do it as soon as possible. But give you access so that you can watch the sessions online if you want to. But it's going to take me maybe some time. I got to get in touch with one of my coworkers about that. Are there any other questions? Please feel free to ask. I want you to have as much knowledge as you need so that when you go out and teach the manual in the community, you can really be responsive to the community members' questions. So if you have any questions, please don't hesitate to ask me. Okay, I don't see any questions. So we can go ahead and end now. As I mentioned at the beginning, so we will have a session next Tuesday. That is gonna be session 3 and 6. We're not going to have a session on the 8th because that's election night. I know that people will go out and vote. You're also going to probably want to watch what the results are. It's going to be pretty interesting. So, you know, you probably don't want to deal with me. So we won't have anything on the 8th, and then we'll all meet in person on the 12th to finish out the sessions in the manual. If you have any other questions, though, in the meantime, so you know, if you got my email, that means you can email me back. You can just respond to the email and I'll get it. So if you have any questions in the meantime, please don't hesitate to contact me to ask. As I said, I'm going to work on getting the presentations up on the website. That may take some time. So I ask you to just be patient with me as I try to get that up there. As I also mentioned, I am going to start working with the cardiologist to have those self-directed modules put up there. They may not be put up there before we meet in person, but then you'll be able to go back and do them a little later. They mainly deal with topics outside of the manual, like peripheral artery disease, congestive heart failure, therapies for congestive heart failure, and then of course like coronavirus, the flu, and vaccination. So if there's no other questions, then I'd like to thank all of you for joining me again tonight. I hope the session was informative. I hope it was, you know, you learned something from it, and that you are excited to learn more. So I look forward to seeing you next week. Thank you, everyone. Have a nice night.
Thank you.
Good night.
Thank you.